You will never be able to reconstruct the process because this and that one has two completely different pictures, two completely different patterns. Well, the idea is that the intussusception is very important in creation of small arteries and veins. This resembles very close the formation of trees, and we call this process intussusceptive arborization. First, the intussusception is important for the enlargement of the capillary plexus. Second, formation of small artery and veins. And I put also additional slide. This is the summary. You could see here small pillars. They reshape here, segregate some segments. They become bigger and bigger. They stand up in the second dimension. On the end, we have the supplying arteries and veins. But what's happened at the bifurcation? This is what Nenad demonstrated before. We found that very often, as such kind of transluminary tissue pillar at the bifurcation, what's happened that they now is a fold from this pillar going to the bifurcation angle, and on the end, this bifurcation angle is splitted. Here is a simulation of that process. Here is a pillar arising here and fold, going deeper and deeper. On the end, this is splitted, the angle becomes sharper, and the diameter of the branching of the daughter vessel become also smaller. And there is a famous Murray's law. The people working with that one should know this much more better than me. And this calculates the optimal diameter of the mother and daughter branches in terms of the optimal chemodynamical conditions at that bifurcation. And with this intussusception, you are optimizing the bifurcation angles during the development because you're increasing the blood flow during the development and blood pressure. And this is also confirming the clinical study with patients with high blood pressure. If you look at of the retinal vessels, the branching, they become smaller and smaller. And we believe that this process play also a very important role in the branching formation of the branching geometry. This process is also able to cut one branch. It's a process known as pruning. If you have eccentric formation of pillars, and these pillars, they fuse as before, as here, on the end, you cut this branching, and this is known as a pruning in the literature. And because it resembles very close the process what you are doing in spring cutting some branches, vascular pruning. This is very important to on after the excessive angiogenesis to bring the whole system to optimal number of size of vessels. This was actually a general introduction showing how this intussusception contributes to the blood vessel formation. And I love all these old papers because at that point they really made a really very nice drawing. They observed very nicely the processes without to have any idea about the intussusception. This was by Clark and Clark. You could see here the guy actually monitored very nicely the processes. This pillar formation eccentrical more and more, and on the end cut it, and the process of vascular pruning. What we believe, this is such kind of a, this first part of summary slides, we believe that after the formation of primitive capillary plexus, and this could be done by vasculogenesis or by sprouting angiogenesis, as long as you don't have any vessel in the tumor, embryonic tissue, it doesn't matter what it is here, we need, or the organism need vessel inviting that structure. They should invite because there is nothing into the tumor tissue. But as soon we have such kind of capillary plexus, there is a switch because with the process of intussusceptive angiogenesis, you could very rapidly increase the entire capillary surface. This process is important because it gives you a mechanism, a tool to make small arteries and veins, and on the end to remodel the branching angles. Are there some questions about that one? Or could I switch to the next one? This was the general introduction. And it's important, it's clinical relevance, I'll come to that one again by the tumors. About the regulatory mechanism, we are working, we have one part of the group is working about the different regulatory mechanisms of intussusception, which was mentioned before, the notch signaling. And you told before us that the notch, if you inhibit the notch, you are getting the dense capillary meshwork. We know, I think we hope we know why, and we have now a paper, we should resubmit, now everything is done for to circulation research. We know that this is due to the intersusception because we have recruitment of stem cells, but I'm going just to show you one picture how this looks like after Notch inhibition. This is the control situation in the chick embryo, and this is after the Notch inhibition, absolutely the same magnification. You could see here a small few pillars, and with that way it's increasing the chick hormetic membrane. But if you apply inhibitor of Notch, you are getting such kind of a plexus. Very, very dense capillary plexus, no one single sprout. Absolutely, with the transgenic mice in the liver. The liver, the normal liver is looking like that, but the Notch liver is looking like that. They are getting a very, very complex a meshwork. There is no sinuses, there are meshwork of capillaries. They are increasing the, there is a portal hypertension, hold the consequences of that on the end to the cirrhosis even. We are working on the molecular mechanism. Once again, I'm not going to talk about that one. Well, there are only two slides because we discussed today about the Notch signaling. But what is important, and most likely it's important for you, many years ago, you even supposed that it could be that the blood flow is one major player in that process. What we did, now it closed one of major branch here, you could see here the bifurcation, if you imagine that here is a bifurcation, we closed that branch, increase the blood flow here by at least 40%, and just you see here in 50 minutes, we have already the first pillars. They fuse with the branching angles, and they remodel very rapidly the branching geometry. And here in vivo observation, only 40 minutes, you have completely different branching angles comparison to that above. At that moment, it was a very, very primitive level, was just the idea that most likely the shear stress should play an important role. If you have low shear stress from that place, actually made the information such kind of a pillar, but need not know about that one much more. What we did a ligation experiment in the chick area vasculosa. You see here, we ligate one part, it's looking absolutely the same on the other part, but we ligate it here, and what's happened, and we did the cast from that part. What was very funny, you have a dense capillary meshwork, and again, here you have a lot of small, tiny pillars. By more fantasy, they are lying in rows, they are lying in lines. And here in that place, this segment will be cut. And the process is very funny, by higher magnification you could see. They are reshaping, they are fusing, and like an opening a zipper, you could segregate, you make from this capillary plexus small arteries and veins. Blood flow is one really important player in the intersusceptive angiogenesis. You are absolutely sure that it's like that. We have the feeling that one side is the VEGF, which is responsible for sprouting angiogenesis, and we were able to show that the process of intersusception is VEGF independent by kidney Taiwan nephritis. If you block the VEGF, the process takes place. If you block it here, this takes place. Actually, this is a VEGF independent mechanism. There are other players. And one of the major other molecular players, and in addition, is the mechanical forces. This is the blood flow. There are not so many people working on that one. I know there's the other papers by Nenad, and also the group of Gabor Sekeli in Zurich. But this is something what is very interesting for us, and we would like to work on it, and we could discuss later on something more about that topic. Now, coming back to the tumors. Why is that important for tumor therapy? We investigated the memory gland in experimental model in the oncogenes induces carcinogenesis, and very often you are able to see such kind of a vascular morphology, and you are able even in vivo to document formation in tumors of such kind of a transformational tissue pillars. This process taking place also in tumors, but you could induce this process. How? Applying the anti-angiogenic therapy and VEGF inhibitors, this is the PTK7/87 developed by Novartis, or irradiate the tumors. In these two cases, you are able to switch the vascular growth from sprouting to intersusception. I'm going to show you that one. There are the morphological data, the curves, and what is interesting that if you irradiate or put anti-angiogenic treatment, and the people are showing, if they are showing some preclinical study, they are showing like that, only the first 2 to 3 weeks. But what after that, what's happened? There is a relapse. The treated tumors, they start to grow very rapid. Why is that one? Once again, this is our details, morphological details. I'm going to the data, which are, in my opinion, are important. What's happened?
We observe a couple of phenomena.
First of all, the tumor revascularization, as soon as you apply the anti-VEGF, VEGF inhibitor, anti-angiogenic compound, the small vessel in the vicinity of the tumor, in the middle of the tumor die, but the periphery remain intact. Why? It was a long story, but on the end, the answer was very, very simple. Because the tumor vessel in the periphery, they are covered by peri-endothelial cells, muscle active cells. That means the tumor vessels in the middle, they are naked. They are only endothelial cells, nothing else. In the periphery, they have a very thick jacket from peri-endothelial cells, muscle cells. If you are going to apply the inhibitor VEGF, you are killing only the immature vessel in the middle, but the mature vessel in the periphery, they are resistant. What's happened later on? The tumor, as soon as you stop the therapy, the tumor starts to proliferate, and I put it here 2 millimeters, and the proliferation starts from the periphery. You see here in the middle there are no proliferating cells, but the PTK or VEGF inhibitor started to proliferate very, very dramatically. Here is the quantification in the periphery. The tumor revascularization, the recovery, start from this preserved vessel in the periphery going direction in the medulla. There is another phenomenon. What's happened here? If you have a look at the control animals, they are growing because they are transgenic mouse, they are going, the tumors are very growing very fast, and they are inducing a lot of sprouting vessels. There are small things here, they are sprouting vessels. But what's happened as soon as you inhibit the tumor by anti-VEGF compound or by irradiation, they change completely the morphology. They change from that one to that one. They are sheet-like with the many, many small tiny holes in between, and that means they are changing the vascular growth mode from sprouting to intussusception. Is there a switch? And to do that one, we do the extended quantification, quantifying the number of pillars, the number of sprouts, and you find really that there is angiogenic switch from sprouting to intussusception. And this one could be an escape mechanism. Why? Because by intussusception, you could apply anti-proliferative drugs that didn't target the vessel because the proliferation rate is very, very low. The permeability is the physiological one. There is no high permeability like by sprouting. They cannot go through the vessels, and it's a very rapid process. This could count to the resistance to the tumor treatment by anti-angiogenic compounds and radiotherapy. What we found that also there is an upregulation of smart muscle cells, what I told you before, in the new smart muscle cells, they are coming in this transluminal tissue pillar, and they making them much more robust. One parameter used by many people is the intratumoral microvascular density. The intratumoral microvascular density is the number of vessels into the tumor. We evaluate that one before and after therapy, and you find out that there is a dramatically decreased by more than 40% in intratumoral vascular density. What's happened if you calculate the exchange surface area? Actually, the surface area which is important for the tumor biology, because this area is important for the exchange of oxygen and nutrition, is more or less the same. The blood vessels are larger, they are bigger, they are in their number is smaller, but they are the periphery, actually, the surface is more or less the same. And this is the reason why this tumor survives after the therapy. Even the hypoxia, which was very prominent in the control animals, believe me, I looked very hard to find a few positive cells for HIF-1 alpha just to show that this is not a control area. There is practically no hypoxia after treatment because the intussusception managed to, after this switch, to supply the tumor with enough oxygen and nutrition. And this is a summary slide showing that process, that without treatment, in the very rapid growing tumors, what we have, because the tumor here is not vascularized, we have the sprouting angiogenesis. A lot of small, tiny sprouts are inviting the tumor tissue. As soon as you apply the anti-VEGF compound, it's killing all these sprouts. They cannot develop anymore. But the tumor, what it's doing, is switching the vascular growth mode from sprouting to intussusception, and now start to grow by intussusception. It's in expanding, not so fast like by sprouting, but it's expanding quite good. And the end of the treatment, after the end of the treatment, the tumor could again switch to sprouting angiogenesis. This is on-off mechanism, and in that way, and this is already confirmed by different quantitative investigation. By that way, the tumor is able to escape the radiotherapy and anti-angiogenic treatment. And we believe that this process, this phenomenon, count to the resistance at that moment to different anti-angiogenic treatment. Even more, we found patients which are resistant, because you are working with many substances from Novartis, from Bayer, they are resistant to the treatment. When looking at the biopsy by thyroid carcinoma, we will find that all these patients, they have such kind of a vascular phenotype. But this is the ongoing study. You need a higher number of patients. But this is the take-home message. The tumors, they could grow by sprouting, they could go by intussusception, and they could switch in between. Depends on the conditions, depends on